He was formerly the Chief of Defence Force of Singapore. Subsequently, he was appointed the Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Education. And after that, he was appointed Chairman of the National Research Agency, ASTAR. Today, he is Chairman of a very critical national agency, the Singapore Food Agency. Lim Chuan Poh, welcome to Inconvenient Questions. We're here to talk about, thank you. We're here to talk about food, Chuan Poh. You know, it's a very critical non-traditional security threat, as you know. You know, unlike water, you know, in the case of water, over the last 40, 50 years, we've become a lot more self-reliant, self-sufficient. But in terms of food, we are still 90% reliant on external sources. Now, that's untenable, you know, and clearly puts us at severe risk. Now, what's being done about this? And perhaps you can give us a little bit of the backdrop, the global backdrop that we need to be cognizant of.
Indeed, you know, we are in a somewhat ironic situation. As you rightly pointed out, you know, we import over 90% of our food. So we're highly dependent on the food sources around the world. But the Global Food Security Index actually ranks Singapore as the most food secure country in the world, and twice in a row. And in the case of this index, it is really that, you know, Singapore has enough food. And this is because when you look at the situation in Singapore, we actually have a wide range of food available, high quality and affordable. And in fact, for Singaporeans, when they look around, they can easily forget that we're highly dependent on other countries for food, and they can become really complacent about this. So what really accounts for this food security? We have really one primary food security strategy, which is import source diversification, which is why today we import food from over 170 different countries in the world. And we want to be sure that...
Yeah, that's interesting, because I remember in the 2007 crisis, in food crisis, where I think there was a severe shortage of eggs. And I found out that we imported eggs in the end, because from Malaysia, the eggs weren't coming. So we imported most of the eggs from Ukraine, as far away as Ukraine. So not only do we have a diversified portfolio, but it's all over the world, right? It's not yes. just in Southeast Asia.
Yes. No, absolutely. But just to be sure, we do import from Ukraine, but we still have most of our eggs coming from local production and from the immediate region. Yeah. But we are very mindful that we want to open up more sources because the geographic separation is quite important. It's integral to the diversification strategy. So it's interesting that, you know, for Singapore, we are in fact bringing eggs from as far away as Ukraine.
It's amazing.
But we will not start at Ukraine. We'll look for other viable, price competitive sources as well.
And so the important thing for us to understand is no matter how much we try, right, we can diversify and so on. But the moment you have national calamities, international global calamities like the current COVID-19 pandemic, right, it kind of disrupts all the plans that we may have, you know, because every country will then start looking at national interests, right? If they will then reduce what is available for exports, then countries like us, you know, we start paying a huge price because the supply chain is disrupted. Yes. How do we hedge this kind of a risk, which is way beyond our control?
Yes. I think first is to understand that this is a complex system, and the issues are related. And we must be careful not to zoom in on a particular causal factor and then only respond to that.
Okay.
And this is why when, notwithstanding that the import diversification strategy has worked for Singapore and will continue to do so for the foreseeable future, we have already started looking at how to make this strategy more robust. And when we look at this, we are very mindful of some of the mega trends that is really already happening around the world. We need to recognize that the global population is going to increase by 2 billion more, which is like, 27% increase by 2050. This is a big increase, and you need a lot of resources set aside to support this significant population increase. Another phenomenon that generally we don't pay attention to is that there's a convergence of diet as income level actually rise in the emerging economies. So a very simple example would be China. China today, on a purchasing power parity basis, is only about one-third that of the US. But on a per capita consumption of meat, it is already half that of the US, and that gap is closing fast. This is why when you take both the population trend and the convergence of diet, taking into account that 1 billion more people will be joining middle class within the next 10 years, the expected demand for food globally, in fact, is going to increase by 60%, not 20% as in the population growth.
And isn't it true that as populations become more affluent, the propensity to consume increases?
Absolutely. And it's not just consumption. It is meat consumption. Animal protein has the biggest demand on natural resources, land, water, not only that, greenhouse gas emission.
Yes.
So there's a real compounding effect. So when you add this together, this will then feed back into the climate change. And unfortunately, once it creates that stress on climate change, it will negatively feed back into the availability of land because of rising sea level, because of extreme weather. So what we thought we had earlier, the land available for food production, in fact, may be significantly reduced because of the negative feedback of the climate change, which is why we need to take this as a complex system and respond to it as a complex system. Even the pandemic is related to climate change because as we have rising population, we need to have more land for the human activities. We come into closer proximity to animals. And the closer we are to animals, you are going to get the zoonotic disease impact. And this is what we are seeing with pandemic. So now we have COVID-19. If you look at how WHO is thinking about this, disease X will be far more challenging than COVID-19. And we have to prepare for that. So when you take all this together, Singapore really has no choice. We got to treat food security as an existential issue. And we have to do better than our present primary strategy of diversification to create something even more robust.
Yeah. So essentially what you're saying is that until now, the primary strategy, as you put it, of a diversified portfolio of food sources, right, has helped us sort of hedge the risk as and when it happens, right?
Yes.
But going forward, because there's a global demand, surging global demand, yes. That alone is not going to help us. That's the hard truth.
Yes.
That alone is not going to help us. So yes. I guess the answer lies in increasing self-sufficiency, right? But the big question is, I mean, if you look at around us, how much of land do we have? You know, I mean, how are we going to be self-sufficient when our population itself is going to be increasing, right? I guess this is where technology and all that come about. So I guess we have to now look internally within Singapore. What is it we can do to change the way the equation is so that we reduce the reliance on external sources? So mm-hmm. are there any specific targets that we have?
So you are absolutely right. We have specific targets, but I just want to give more tangibility to the challenge that we are confronting with. Because today we import 90% of our food. Imagine if we were to flip that around and say we want to produce 90% of our food. So that's the first parameter that we want to change. And not only that, we want to produce food in a fairly advanced way. Using Germany as an example, they produce 90% of their food. And they have very sophisticated high technology farming. But of course, a large part of that is open farming or greenhouse farming. So using that as the example, and noting that Germany set aside nearly half their landmass for food production, you have to note that if we were to adopt the same method and produce 90% of our food, we will need 18 Singapore just to meet our present food requirement.
Yeah. Yeah.
On the other hand, the stretch target that Singapore aspires to is to make use of less than 1% of our land to produce as much as we can, arising from that 1%. And of course, the only solution is to leverage on research, leverage on technology to really scale up the productivity, which is why we had a very ambitious target. We want to produce 30% of our nutritional needs by the year 2030.
And that's less than 10 years down.
This is less than 10 years down the road. And this is coming from, you know, now producing less than 10%. So it's a threefold increase and still being constrained by the less than 1% of land set aside for food production. So it's a really, really stretched target. And the only way for us to be able to do that is to leverage on research and the technological adoption.
So can you give us some idea of the kind of success we have had so far in making this shift towards tech-driven agro-industry?
Yes. So this is a very important point because we should not just jump into this, you know, just because it's the right thing to say. We have to ask, what are the factors, what are the conditions that are already present in Singapore and what we can leverage on to in fact create the solutions? I think one very positive element is that Singapore has always maintained a strong manufacturing base.
Yeah.
And it's not any manufacturing, but one that's very advanced. In fact, we started this journey of going down the future of manufacturing, advanced manufacturing, along the Industry 4.0 suite of technologies about maybe 5 to 7 years ago. So this level of capability is already present in Singapore. The really high-end farming today fully adopt as much as they can the Industry 4.0 technologies. When you look at the proliferation of indoor urban farming, those that really can scale up at 10 to 20 times, if not 30 times, the productivity per unit area, these are all the farms, indoor farms that have adopted Industry 4.0 suite of technologies, sensors, LED light, analytics, and also very efficient use of water, nutrients, very controlled environment, don't need to use pesticide, very little food spoilage, you know. So when we invest in those areas, we can use much, much less land area and then grow a lot more. So it's grow more with less. So this is one prong that is very, very significant for Singapore, and we're leveraging on what we have already built up and then just customizing it, adapting it for using in the indoor urban farming context.
I can see now why you were appointed chairman of SFA, because of your experience as chairman of A-Star, your exposure to research, what is cutting edge technology. I'm sure a lot of that wisdom accumulated is now being transferred here. I can see that. So you don't have to acknowledge it, but I can see that. But what, coming back to this point about land use of land, right? So I believe that a lot of the agro tech industry would be using surfaces like the rooftops of HDB and so on. I mean, are there plans to deploy as many more HDB blocks?
That is part of the solution, because we are missing another bigger prong of leveraging on the future of science to impact food security. So I've spoken about indoor urban farming, which is relying on the Industry 4.0 technology. But there's another one that is coming up that is almost like a miracle. Imagine having eggless eggs, steak without the cow, milk without the cow. That is what is already possible. It's just not scaled up, but you can see some of this already being served in our restaurants. You go to PS Cafe, you can order a regular burger or you can order an Impossible Burger. Impossible Burger is completely plant-based protein, but because of research, they discovered this heme protein that makes that Impossible Burger taste just like a regular burger.
So it's like your Buddhist mock meat kind of stuff.
So that's the so-called plant-based alternative protein approach. At the same time, there are already companies going straight into the animal protein, using stem cell biology, using bioprocessing to scale up, and then serving you that meat that is entirely beef, not plant substitute, and all produced out of research. So this is going to come. They are now at the point of trying to cost down so that it can be price competitive, or at least just a tolerable premium over existing products. And all these are coming. But very importantly, this is not just in the animal meat that we are looking at. It's also happening to seafood. So prawns, there are already efforts underway to produce prawn meat. You may not see the entire prawn, the shell and the fillers and all that, but you can have this prawn protein mixed with the other ingredients and have them in your prawn balls, which is what, in fact, by volume, consumed by in a much bigger way in the market. So this second prong is longer term, but this is the one that will in fact significantly reduce the demand on the resources on this planet, at the same time producing the kind of food that will give us assurance of food security. So you have one prong that's more immediate to medium term. You have another prong that's medium term to longer term, but you already see evidence of it here today.
How advanced is the research in this? I mean, is the research in these kind of areas, which is fascinating, right? Is it being done in Singapore or is it being done elsewhere in the world? If so, which countries?
Singapore has always been rated as one of the strongest countries in terms of stem cell biology. And for many decades now, we have always invested in understanding bioprocessing, mainly because we have a very big biology industry. And this same concept of bioprocessing in a bioreactor is used in the biology industry, will also be used in the food industry. If anything, the demands in the food industry is significantly less than the demand in the drug industry. So this is why it's called pharma grade. This is food grade. It's actually a different order of demand because you're not trying to treat someone. You're just making sure that it's tasty, it is safe. It doesn't kill anyone in the process of eating.
And in the end, so you're giving technology. We are giving people options.
And we are giving people options.
Yeah, because today, compared to even 10 years ago, there are so many different types of people with dietary restrictions and dietary demands, right? Yes. You have people who are vegan, for example, and so on. So I think we also need to provide options for different types of people. Yes. I'd like to come back to, because we have only about three minutes left, I'd like to come back to Singapore and say, now, apart from technology, agrotech, where we are going full speed ahead, apart from this sort of research that we are talking about, which is fascinating, what else from a sociological point of view do you think we can do or is being done to change attitudes, for example? For example, food wastage, right? There's a huge amount of wastage of food. I have a heartache every time I go to hotels, and I see and I imagine the amount of food that's going to be wasted, what is being done in the social aspects of it, the attitudinal shift, what's being done about getting more young people to join the food industry, become farmers perhaps, are we getting any success in these areas?
Mm-hmm. So there are several questions in the remarks that you've just made.
Yeah.
Let me try and unpick them. Firstly, food waste. Globally, one third of food is wasted. And typically, the food is wasted at two ends of the spectrum. One is at production. One is at the consumption end. Production, if you look at India, they really have some challenges with food already. On the other hand, 40% of the food that's been produced never get to the market because of spoilage, because of problems in the logistic to bring the food to the market. Yeah. So this is one end. We are less in that space because right now we import 90% of our food. But at the consumption end, this is an issue. And this is a social behavioral issue. And it is just not socially responsible if you waste food. And when you waste food, it is not just the fact that you can afford, so you waste the food. Once you waste food, you actually demand more food, and this then circulate back into the overall complexity that will threaten climate and therefore negatively impact our future.
This is actually
we have to be very, very mindful of this.
This is actually an externality of the circular economy, right?
It is a very big externality. So what can we do? Obviously, we need to set certain target. And in fact, the ministry has set target for zero waste. Then food waste is part of this zero waste. And the plan is to try and reduce by 30% our overall waste on a daily basis by the year 2030. So there's another 30 by 30 on the waste side. But just coming back to another phenomenon on the positive side. So you mentioned the multi-story car park. So one of our strategy, in fact, is to bring food production to the heartlands, to the community. Imagine if you get a chance to see how food is being produced. Better still, if you participate in the process of production, by the time the end product comes to you, I think you'll look at it very differently. You will value it, you'll treasure it, and you'll minimize the wastage of it. So that part of this behavioral change, I think, is something that we want to do. And we want to do early school students participating. We also want to do with the community, especially the retired population, the aging population. If they get involved in this, they're active, they also have a healthier lifestyle. So everything comes together when we create these kind of opportunities for the community to participate in food production.
So what we're talking about
is a big movement.
Yeah, what we're talking about is fascinating, really. What we're talking about is get people to be involved in the problem, directly involved in the problem,
and
so that they
appreciate
and own the issue. And so we are likely to be creating a very large number of amateur farmers, so to speak, and putting it bluntly. What about the professional farmers? Do you think we can get more and more of our younger people who are tech savvy, for example, to go into farming as a vocation? Do you think
I definitely believe so. And it's not farming the way you envisage it, but along the two pillars that I spoke about just now, the indoor urban farming, and then the alternative proteins, the future foods pillar. Just to give you a very exciting story, two A-star scientists, when I was still in the chairman of A-star, they did a spin-out called Shiok Meat. And this is the company that's focused on producing prawn meat. When I was in Berlin last year, there was a slide that showed 40 over companies involved in future food. And Singapore has one flag planted because of Shiok Meat. They managed to raise money already, and they are now in the process of trying to get the cost down, the production process are going on. Of course, there's some interruption because of COVID-19. But it's only a matter of time before you can see this in our restaurants, in our supermarket. But this is not the only company. There are many now that are in this space, and the numbers are multiplying very fast. It's true in this space, likewise in the indoor urban farming. So I'm not seeing a shortage of this young people coming to this industry. Very significantly, there's another phenomenon that's happening, and you probably see this in your own children. The younger generation, the millennials, they are very aware of climate change. And they want to make choices, both in terms of their consumption and also their own aspiration in career to serve some bigger cause.
Yes.
Which is why when you look at the food industry development, the way Singapore is embarking on this, this is the kind of thing that I think the younger generation of Singaporeans aspire to do, because they are producing and they are working in the space that is really great, not just for Singapore, but for the wider humanity.
Well, you know, Chuan Poh, that's fabulous. And I think that's the best way to end this, best note to end this interview on. You know, it's inspirational, it's highly informative what you shared. And I can see that you yourself are highly inspired by the work that you have been assigned. You know, I wish you all the best, and I look forward to farming with you.
Thank you very much. And I look forward to sharing the food with you.
Wonderful. Thank you very much, Chuan Poh. All the best.
Thank you.